So let's pray. Father, thank you for the update we got in our brother Ed, and just praying, Lord, that this time in that rehabilitation center will help him, Lord, regain the clarity of mind and thought. Lord, we miss him here serving so faithfully, serving at the front door on Wednesdays and Saturdays, and just serving however he can, whenever he can. And I know he misses that, Lord. So strengthen our brother, restore his health, bring him back to us, Lord. And God, I just thank you for your faithfulness, especially as I look through these prayer requests and think about how you've moved in so many areas over the years, praying together with my brothers. And it's always good to just give you praise and thanks when we hear about answers to prayer, like Jeff's mom, Marion, and that surgery being moved up so that it's going to happen this month instead of next month. And Lord, thank you for that. Or just simple things like that that just stir our hearts to thank you, to be grateful, Lord, as we should. And Lord, with Daniel lifting up the ongoing, hopefully one day ending, but the ongoing situation in our country, Lord, with treatment of the unborn as something less than your creation, less than a child, less than a baby. And so, Lord, we pray for that day. And a couple of requests came in for that, Lord, and just the reversal of that Supreme Court decision that makes that possible. Lord, we pray that would be struck down. And and Lord, most importantly, for the hearts that would just look at a life less than a life, Lord, it's just the condition of the heart, the human heart, that hasn't been transformed by you, Lord. We were there, that was us, even if we weren't supporting abortion as unbelievers, Lord. We had a hardened heart that was definitely contrary in plenty of ways to your ways. So, Lord, we pray for those folks that perhaps are in our spheres of influence, Lord, just kind of wanting to be more specific than everybody that would favor the killing of the unborn. But, Lord, those in our spheres of influence, our family and friends, people we love, people you've put us in connection with, that have just been blinded, Lord, by the evil one as to this area. And so, Lord, please be moving in those that we love to open their eyes, Lord, to see their need, really. That's the ultimate thing, their need for you and the provision you've made. Lord, also Daniel's prayer for your Holy Spirit speaking to the hearts of decision makers in this process, and thanking you for your son Jesus, and that we would all say amen for his death and resurrection. And Lord, ongoing prayer again for the unborn and for just the spiritual blindness. Lord, your word speaks of that, talks about just the powers of darkness that move in areas of influence, whether that be government and Lord, so many areas, really not limited to that for sure, but definitely that has an impact on us, Lord. And so, God, we pray for just those strongholds to be broken, Lord, and all that they affect, from government and every area of influence in our lives and in our nation. Lord, a prayer request also added for our neighbors to the north in Canada. Lord, as we got some truckers up there that just trying to make a statement peaceably, and so, Lord, we pray for them to be able to do so with their convoys. Lord, with our brother Rich, we are praying for his mom, Patricia, and just some ongoing chronic health issues. And Lord, until you deal with something like that, it's hard to have the empathy for that. But Lord, these are areas that just can debilitate a person and discourage a person and even affect a person emotionally and mentally, even when it's physical. And so, Lord, we pray for your healing touch on his mom, Patricia. And then, Lord, with our brother Todd, praying for the self-employed brothers and sisters of Refuge. Lord, and there are many in this room tonight of our brothers that have taken that step of faith to be self-employed and trust you on a regular basis, Lord, to bless the business that they do as unto you and to bring more business. So, Lord, we pray for your blessing upon our brothers here, including Todd and Mike and Bob and others that would be in that category. And, Lord, for our marriages, Lord, praying for the marriages in this room and asking you, Lord, to help us really do our part, the men that are married, to love our wives like your son, Jesus, loves the bride, his church. Lord, got all the insight we need on that for sure in your word. So, Lord, may we look to you to show us those areas where we're missing it and look to you also for the power of your spirit. And Lord, I pray that for all of us, married or not, Lord, to carry out our individual callings. And if we see areas that we're blowing it, missing it, coming up short, more just to be honest before you and say, God, I'm missing it here. I need your help. I want your help. And Lord, just to confess that and receive that provision from you, Lord. And Father, tonight, thanks. Thanks for the blessing just to be with brothers in unity. Lord, definitely we're different in so many ways, but we're unified in the most important way, Lord, and that is we're your kids, we're your sons. We've been adopted into your family. We're co-heirs together. Lord, we approach you all the same. We're all in the same common ground, Lord, of grace. Lord, so thank you for that common ground. I pray it'll stir our hearts to sing these songs with gratefulness to you. In Jesus' name, amen. So, hey, we are in Ephesians chapter 5. We're going to finish Ephesians chapter 5. Whoa, rich stuff for everyone. Rich application. And Brother Marty is in the wings. He's got his water. Most importantly, he's got his Bible. And he's going to bring the word. So let's welcome our Brother Marty, okay?
All right, brothers, get set up here. You all set? How was your week? Yeah, it's good. Had a very smooth week this week, and it's always nice to have those smooth weeks compared to those that we have challenges. I mean, there's a lot of those during the week that we go, man, I had a lot of hurdles to get over this week sometimes, right? But it's nice to have those smooth ones that kind of make up for those rough waters that we all go through. Well, tonight, we're going to be in Ephesians chapter 5, and God willing, we'll finish up the chapter. But I'll tell you, before we go any further, this is a rich chapter. I'd really like to come before the Lord in prayer. So, Heavenly Father, we just thank you for those smooth-flowing weeks, but we know as this life progresses, there's rough waters ahead. There's rapids, there's waterfalls that we have to avoid, Lord. And so we need you to teach us how to avoid those things, those pitfalls in our life, those trials that you have. But we also know that those trials in our life, they help mature us and grow us as your children. So, Father, do that work in our hearts tonight. We just ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, in the first three chapters of Ephesians, kind of as a quick recap, Paul's been outlining all the blessings that we have in Christ. And if you missed those last week's teachings, make sure you check them out online, or if you missed a few, check them out. They're all worthwhile. Paul writes in the first chapter that God has blessed us first with every spiritual blessing. We are God's own special creation. We are his workmanship, his poema. And we were created in Christ Jesus for these good works, that we should what? Walk in them. And starting in chapter 4, Paul now says, in light of all these blessings that we have from God, he says, walk this way. He says, walk worthy of the calling in which you were called, with all lowliness and gentleness, with long suffering, bearing with one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. See, Paul has already taught us that we should not walk as the rest of the world walks, in the futility of their minds, that is, thinking that they have all the answers. And now in chapter 5, Paul encourages us to be what? Imitators of God. As dear children, he says, walk in love, as Christ has also loved us and given himself for us. Are you guys kind of following Paul's flow of thought here? We have these spiritual blessings in God. Therefore, walk as a child of God. Imitate your heavenly Father like a little child, right? Like our kids and our grandkids try to imitate their daddy or their papa. The key word, though, that you'll not want to overlook here in these chapters is walk. The word walk is used over 36 times in Paul's letters. And I found it interesting that every single time Paul uses this word walk, it's always used in the plural. It's always how we should walk, how you, y'all, should walk. That kind of gives us the indication that the Christian walk should never be a solo trek. The Christian walk is a journey that we share together as brothers and sisters and families and as the body of Christ. As men, we're like these mountain climbers, all tethered together to climb Mount Everest. If one brother falls or slips, man, he's not going anywhere because he's tied on to the guy next to him. We just lift him up and pull him back up onto his feet. That's the idea. Now, we don't really have time to cover all those walks in all Paul's letters tonight, but I would encourage you on your own this week, just look up the word walk in like Blue Letter Bible or Bible Gateway and let God's word speak to you how we should be walking as God's men. So let's walk back to chapter 5. Paul continues this theme in verse 8 and tells us to let the light of God expose those unfruitful works of darkness. See that rotten fruit for what it is. And to do what? Verse 8, walk as children of light. And now, starting in verse 15, where we ended last week, Paul says to see that you walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time, because the days are evil. Alan had pointed out last week that to walk circumspectly means to walk carefully, accurately, and with purpose. And the idea is to use the time that God has allotted you, each of us, wisely and for God's glory. Therefore, continuing on in verse 17, therefore, Paul writes, do not be unwise, but understand what the will of the Lord is. See, the world that we live in, it's filled with danger. It's filled with snares and traps and temptations from the enemy. Paul says, don't be a fool. Don't be ignorant to these things that are in front of you. Don't allow them to trip you up, wasting the time God has allotted you on wasteful pursuits. My mama used to say, Brian, that's my middle name, Brian, You're just frittering your time away. You guys ever hear that? Frittering your time away? Yeah, it usually means that you're wasting your life away on meaningless pursuits. In my case, growing up, it was comic books and Mad Magazine. Any of you guys? Comic books, Mad Magazine? Yep, few of you. Paul says we must be careful to live out our life in God's wisdom and not to live the life of a fool. Therefore, the will of the Lord that Paul speaks of here is that we should live our lives circumspectly, carefully, accurately, and purposely, always using our time wisely and to be matching our daily lives to that of Scripture. Verse 18, Paul writes, "And do not be drunk with wine, which is dissipation, but be filled with the Spirit." You see, Paul was talking to the Ephesians here. And in Ephesus, that was the city of all pagan ritual and worship. And one of the gods that they used to worship there was the god Bacchus. And Bacchus was the god of wine and pagan orgies. They believed that they best pleased Bacchus and received blessings from Bacchus when they were drunk. It was then in this drunken stupor that they would learn how to best serve him. Paul's been teaching the Ephesians how to walk with God according to God's plan and not that of the world. And he's trying to teach them that you don't please God by filling your stomachs with wine, but rather allowing the Holy Spirit to fill you. This word that Paul uses, dissipation, quite literally means the squandering of a resource to make it nothing. Picture this for a moment. Guys are out in the desert. It's about 115, 118 degrees outside. You're hot. You're dehydrated. So what happens? Your loving wife comes along. We'll talk about her later. Your loving wife comes along, gives you a cold, almost frozen bottle of water. But instead of drinking it and being refreshed, you open up the cap and you end up just dumping it on the sand. Well, what happens to that water after your wife has slugged you in the arm, right? What happens? Well, the water dissipates. It's taking that which was useful to restore you, to nourish you, and it makes it useless. This is Paul's description of getting drunk with wine. We're taking the valuable resource of time that God has given us and making it useless because we're drunk. Paul says the wise man of God chooses rather to be filled with the Spirit rather than drunk with wine. To be filled with the Spirit means to have a heart that is surrendered to God's work in your life and a willingness to be emptied of self so that God can fill us with his Spirit. Just remember, guys, the more we take this glass that's filled up with our life and we dump out everything we have before the Lord, the more he's able to fill it. And what does the Spirit-filled life look like? Well, take a look at verse 19. It says, speaking to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord, giving thanks always for all things to God the Father, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, submitting to one another in the fear of God. I say, amen, Paul. Man, to me, this verse is one of those, drop the mic. This is the reason, guys, that you're to come Monday night and join the choir. I'm just saying, you know... I had the pleasure of, a week ago, last Sunday, I was blessed to do my first baby dedication. my granddaughter Adeline. She turned 1 year old. And Melissa and Christopher asked me if I'd be willing to do the baby dedication. Well, I'll tell you, the real blessing was not being able to do the ceremony. The real blessing was seeing two different families, all that love Jesus. The blessing was seeing my son Christopher and his wife Melissa all want to serve and honor Jesus by choosing to raise their children to know Jesus. Maybe that day we didn't sing a lot of hymns or spiritual songs. Now, we did sing Happy Birthday, right? And there was a lot of hooper and hollering a week ago last Sunday because we were watching the games. I actually performed the ceremony in between the two games, so it was kind of fun. But here's what we were doing. We were loving on each other, sharing a meal, and thanking Jesus for Adeline and asking God to bless her life. How? By coming to know him. Paul's point is, this isn't just a checklist of things we're to do. Being filled with the Spirit means we're always to have that attitude of gratitude in our life. That song that Paul says we're to sing originates in our heart, not our mouth. And it flows almost effortlessly out of the Spirit that's dwelling in us. In verse 21, Paul says that along with this attitude of gratitude, we're to be, though, submitting to one another in the fear of God. Unfortunately, that word submitting or submit has gotten a really bad rap in our culture. We usually think of submitting in very negative ways. It's like, will you submit to my authority? Will you yield? In wrestling, we might call it tapping out. Or in the movie Bloodsport, it's mate. You guys know Bloodsport? Old movie. Anyway, the biblical, though, meaning of submission is not like that at all. There's no wrestling match in the body of Christ. The word in the Greek is hoopotasso. Hoop, think shooting hoops, otasso, hoopotasso. And it means to place under or to subordinate. Now, in the army, you have your generals, lieutenants, majors, colonels, and I'll get these all wrong, by the way, captains, sergeants, and, say, privates. Note that there is no inferiority implied between these designations. The difference between a private and a general is just a different rank. The general holds a different position of authority than that of a private. Now, when Paul says in verse 21 to be submitting to one another in the fear of God, he's saying, men, family, you're all the same rank, but treat each other with the same respect as you would someone with higher authority. Just as we have reverent respect for God, treat each other with the same respect. And this is Paul's point. He's saying, have an attitude of gratitude and mutual submission among believers. And all this is a characteristic of then being filled with the Spirit. Now, as we get into the final verses of chapter 5, Paul's going to move from this general walk that we're doing into a very specific kind of walk. And starting in verse 22, Paul will teach us the foundation of how to walk out a married life. May I preface this session, this section, by saying, men, I have not always been a very good husband or even the head of my family. You guys ever feel that way, that man, I've made some stupid mistakes, said some stupid things, made some big blunders. Man, Todd said, you know, we're all knuckleheads. I love that word that he uses. We're knuckleheads, and we do stupid things, and we say stupid things. Well, as I was being convicted by the enemy of all the wrong choices I've made in my life as a father and as a husband, I was comforted by God with this reminder, men, that the God we put our faith in is so gracious, so forgiving, and loves us so much. See, God doesn't require perfection. God just desires our sincere love and worship of Him. God is bigger than our failures. And He will use those experiences we've made in our life to strengthen our walk with Him. I truly would not be the man I am today had I not made the mistakes I made. So with that in mind, let's see what Paul says about walking out a God-centered marriage. First, he's going to talk about the roles of the wives. Verse 22, wives, submit to your own husbands as to the Lord. So for all you wives out there, or wives online, yeah? Hey, hello out there if there's any watching. Men, I'll tell you, we like this statement. You know, submit to your husbands as to the Lord. I think we like that statement a little bit too much. It's like, wife, obey me. Get me dinner. Get me a drink. Love me. We get to order around, tell her what to do. Now, God in His wisdom gave me a wife, Pam. Pam's my wife. And she's a Texas girl. And I'll tell you, how far do you think that would go if I started ordering Pam around? Not going to fly in our household. Remember, men, and any ladies online, that word submit is not a negative insinuation. It doesn't mean inferiority. See, God loves all of His children equally. Scripture teaches us that both male and female are made in God's image. Paul writes in Galatians 3:28 that there is neither Jew nor Greek, slave or free, male or female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. Ladies, to submit your husbands as to the Lord also doesn't mean that you need to allow Him to abuse you. Men, and I'll ask you a question. You can answer it for the ladies. If we're to ask our wives to sin, should they do it? If we ask them to steal from their boss, should they do it? No, of course not. Following God's commands always outranks us. Ladies, you do, though, submit to God first and then to your husband. But men, we have to understand this about our wives, is that when she is lovingly submitting to us, she is also lovingly serving the Lord. Paul continues this description in verse 23. Paul writes, "For the husband is the head of the wife, as also Christ is head of the church, and He is the Savior of the body." The struggles we face in our marriages, man, I'll tell you, they've been epic throughout the years. The movies and the TV industry are filled with them. And these struggles usually show up in three different ways. Number one, first thing, we have a headless home or marriage. And that's where nobody really makes any decisions in the household. Do we go to church this week? I don't know, do you want to go to church this week? Well, we got up kind of late, I'm kind of tired. And we allow the flesh then to make the decision in our lives when we know what we should be doing. No one's there to take charge of the family, to be the man that they're called to be, to be the spiritual leader of their family. The second problem is we have a marriage with two heads. You can imagine, head over here, head over there. They're all going saying, I want to go this way. No, I want to go that way. And suddenly there's this huge tug of war of who's in control in the family. You know, should we buy this car? Should we buy that car? What type of towels should we buy? I mean, everything can be in a conflict in our family if there's two heads of the family. It doesn't work. And then we have the problem that we have the wrong head on the wrong body. See, God has ordained that man has a special place of authority in the family. And he's called us to be head of our household. Women are to submit to that. But again, that's only part of it. We're going to get into the men's portion in a moment. But see, sometimes the lady, especially here in Southern California, man, they want to take the lead. They want to take the ball. They want to take their men, wrap them up, tie them up, and drag them along beside them. And that isn't the way that God ordained a family to run. In verse 24, Paul says, therefore, just as the church is subject to Christ, so let wives be to their own husbands in everything. In life, see, God has placed all of us in different levels of authority, hasn't he? In your business place, you might have the CEOs, and then you have the division manager. It's common. These are not inferiority type items. The worker is not inferior to their lead. We see that in the church. You know, we see Pastor Bill being the head visionary, the senior pastor for the church. He's the one that has the vision for the church. And all of the people that work under that to keep the natural flow of the church working. Well, I'm sure if you asked Alan, do you feel, inferior to anyone in the church? Of course not. You know, we're all part of the same body of Christ. All trying to serve the one Lord with all our hearts and all our desires. We all have the same goal in mind. Paul says, just as the church, the body of Christ, is submitted to Jesus, so wives are to be submitted to their husbands in everything. Did Paul really write in everything? Look at that. Look at the words. Paul said, submit to their husbands in everything. That is, everything that doesn't lead our wives into sin, right? I'll tell you the truth. I found this verse a little hard for me to understand. So I went to my authoritative guiding tool, Pam. I went to my wife. I talked to her about this passage and her role as a wife and submitting to me. And I asked her if she had any female insights or feelings. I asked her if I had ever made her feel inferior or like a second-class citizen in the family. May I say first, she was overly kind with her words to me. And this is what she pointed out. Number one, some insights from a female point of view. She said that in some cultures, especially those of an Asian descent, it's kind of very normal for men to be the leader of their families and the decision makers in the home. But here in Southern California, she says she's always felt this extreme pressure as a woman of God to take control of all the choices, to show her strength as a woman and not submit to anyone. I then asked her, why do you submit to me then? She simply said, because I love you, and I trust in your judgment. You know what I told her? I told her that it takes real strength and courage to do it God's way and not the world's way. I may be a very weak man, and I am, but I have a very strong woman of God that stands beside me. Number two, she also noted that by submitting to me, it actually gave her this feeling of peace, knowing that final decision wasn't up to her. I never thought of it that way. She goes, I don't have to make the final decision of whether to buy the car, whether to buy the house, whether to buy the timeshare. She doesn't have to make any of those decisions. She said that since she had full confidence in my decisions, she always felt that her feelings and insights were both valued and respected, but in the end, she trusted me that I'd make the best decision I could at the time. Now, the truth is, I have not always made the best decisions as a father, a husband, or a businessman. But for 37 years, going on 38 this May, Pam has always stood there right beside me every step of the way. That being said, men, Paul has a lot to teach us how to be a loving husband to our wives. Verse 25, husbands now. Husbands, love your wives, just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for her. Wow. Husbands, love your wives, just as Christ loved the church and gave himself for her. Wow, Paul, you're setting that bar awfully high, aren't you? Love your wives, just as Christ loved the church? How do I do that? So, brothers, men, how long should we love our wife? Forever. One man, one woman, one lifetime. What God has joined together, let no man separate. The two shall become one flesh. How much are we to love our wife? We're to love our wife as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for her. Paul says that we are to sacrificially love our wife, holding nothing back from her, seeking her needs and desires before our own. Which makes me beg the question, and it asks Marty, Marty, how am I showing love for Pam today? How much of my time do I sacrifice from my studies or watching TV to spend with her each day? How much time do I spend with her planning our next fun night out or our next vacation or getting actively involved in her dreams, her hobbies, her goals? Paul says simply, husband, love your wives just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for her. Men, it isn't always the high bar we're looking for, but it's the little things we do every day that let her know that she's loved. And here's the reason that we are to love our wife this way, in verse 27, that he might sanctify and cleanse her with the washing of water by the word, that he might present her to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she should be holy and without blemish. Christ loves the church, the whole body of Christ. And it's God's desire for his church to be holy, that is set apart for him and his purposes. The way that God sanctifies and cleanses us is through the revelation and study of his word. As we begin to ingest more and more of God's word, it shapes our values and our daily choices, transforming us more into the image of Jesus. So Paul's summary to the husbands is this, verse 28. So husbands ought to love their own wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself, for no one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes it and cherishes it, just as the Lord does the church. Men, think for a moment about your daily needs. What do you need? What do you need in life? Well, we need some rest. Getting rest is good when we're tired. Amen. We need to eat. Yeah, we like to eat. Barbecue stuff. We need exercise to remain healthy. We need clean water to drink. And we all need friends and brothers to share life with. We all need to be loved, needed, wanted, cared for, and valued. Paul says, now think of your wife's needs. She needs those same things you do. And it's not demeaning to ask your wife the question, honey, what can I do to help you today? What can I do for you today? How can I make your life a little bit easier? How can I help? We are to feed the needs of our wife as if we're feeding our own body. There are things in her life, though, that only you can give her. Only you can give her that type of physical intimacy that she needs. Only you can inspire and encourage her in a way that nobody else can. Only you can make her feel loved unconditionally, like Christ loves the church. Paul says to nourish and cherish that relationship, just as the Lord does the church. Why? Look at verse 30. For we are members of his body, of his flesh and of his bones. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. From the day you were married, your life is never the same. Pastor Bill used to always use the analogy that when men, you get married, he says, get ready to die to yourself. The joining of husband and wife is like the merging of these two great rivers. Picture a river on the right, river on the left, and they're starting to merge. Well, as these rivers come together, there's a lot of turmoil and rocks are turned over and boulders come out and it starts cutting paths through the tree. But you know what? Further down the river, these rivers start merging and the waters get deep and the river gets wide, calms down, and it becomes a greater river than it ever was in the first place. The two rivers have now become one and are so much stronger than they ever were alone. Paul says in verse 32 that this joining of husband and wife, that this is a great mystery, but I speak concerning Christ and the church. So what is this mystery that Paul's talking about concerning the church and Christ? Well, Paul's been speaking of the mystery of husband and wife, that becoming one flesh. In a sense, Adam, think of Adam and Eve. Adam was never complete. He was always longing for something. He was never complete, never made whole without Eve. So too the church, the body of Christ, is never whole without becoming one with Jesus. Paul finishes up in verse 33. Nevertheless, let each of you in particular so love his wife as himself, and let the wife see that she respects her husband. So the key ingredients for a good marriage? Husbands, Love your own wife as if she were your own body. She has the same needs as you do. So be more than just a provider to her. Be a lover and a respecter of her. Wives, respect your husbands. You know, Pam, she always respected me, even when I didn't deserve it. And what did that make me do? Well, it made me want to love her more. Mutual love and respect is the key to unity and a healthy marriage. Amen? Amen. Amen. Heavenly Father, we are so thankful for your word. So thankful for all the blessings we have in you. Oh, but Father, we need your help and your guidance as we walk out in this world. Father, teach us how to stay on course by keeping our eyes on you. Help us to be those wise men of God, to use our time that you have allotted each of us for your good and for your glory. Father, just teach us how to be like you, better fathers. Help us to imitate you and imitate Jesus as husbands, as businessmen. Father, we seek to serve you better. We love you, Father, and we thank you so much for this time being with us. Amen.
My heart set free, my soul. I don't wanna be a prisoner no more. Unlock the door that holds me in. This is the day that life begins.